All right, last talk of the day. You almost made it. And nobody followed the advice to sit in the first rows. You guys are still in the back. What is that? Huh? Is that the Budapest attitude or what? Come on, let's get the circulation up. Everybody get up. Everybody get up and move front. Come on. Leadership, let's do it. Move up front. Come on. It'll get your circulation going. It's good. Come on. Get up and move forward. Do it. I have to connect this, so then we will be fine. Sorry? I haven't done anything yet. Really? Come on. Show that I have a little bit of influence. Not you up there, obviously. That'll end in disaster. Yeah, come on. There you go, my buddy. There you go. So just to make sure that you hate me from the start, right? That guy's looking at me like that can't end well. Okay. I just hope my voice makes it through the night. So, are we good? Sorry? Is it good? It looks fine. Zoin, sound will be there? Okay. All right, so as introduced, I'm the founder and CEO of this company, Resourceful Humans, which is a wordplay on human resources. Because my claim to fame is that I was the head of HR for one of Europe's biggest video games companies. And when I started working there, we were like 200 people. And when I left 4 years later, we were 1,500. And we basically turned the organization from a very classical management model into a networked organization, which led to the fact that there was no HR needed, so we managed ourselves out of a job. Yay. If we had known that before, right? No, but back then our CEO, what he said was like, look man, we're making kick-ass video games here. What we don't need is human resources. We don't know people, you know, who just feel like they're just doing a job until 5 o'clock. We need people who think proactively, who are engaged, who work with us. We need resourceful humans. And we're like, there we go. We're not going to call this department human resources. We're going to rebrand it Resourceful Humans. And that's how it started. And then when we went out of our jobs and we founded our own company, remember, this was all before agile or digital transformation or design thinking. It was all just called making kick-ass video games. I don't think even, there was no Twitter back then. Anyway, which is funny, I just had a conversation with my 12-year-old. You just heard I had 5 kids. And we had this very meaningful conversation, father to daughter, which was, there was a time when there was no internet. To which my daughter replied, how did you get on YouTube? Yeah, mental models. So the important bit why we're working and helping companies as an entrepreneurial network is because we've done these transformations. So we're not just talking about it. We've done this long before it became a fashion. And we're working like this ourselves. So all our people are all over the place. So we have actually an office in Berlin, a nice big office, but most of our crew is working all over the place in all these different kind of places. So we were founded in 2011. We have 30 people now. We're homebrew, bootstrapped. We have no investors in. That's why we grew slowly. But all the IP is ours, and we can do whatever the fuck we want. Well, incidentally, awesome. Normally, when I go to these talks and I say, fuck, I always feel bad because I'm the only dude. Before, like, the university professor guy, he's like, fuck, shit, piss, con. It was like, I feel good. So, 8 different countries. And we make technology to enable, grow, and sustain network organizations. Because that's what we do. We network as well as a company, right? We got a thing with bigger organizations. Even the bigger organizations are in more need to do this because they got a lot more bureaucracy and hierarchy and pain with innovation and all of that. So they come to us for help because what we do actually scales. Now, I'll tell you about what we do with them in a moment, so this will be very practical for you. We've also won a lot of awards for what we've done. So in 2014, 2007, the Innovation Award of the Human Resources Excellent People. Gary Hamel has called us out for being pretty awesome in 2015 with our technology. And we've done something so awesome that we even got... Do you guys know Fearless Girl, that bronze statue that stands in front of the bull in New York? Yes, yeah, so we got one of those because of something that you'll see also. So what we do is recognize. Have you read this before? This is one of my favorite quotes. Because right now, you can't get a client meeting in Berlin if you don't say first, digital transformation, and you may come in, sir. Yeah? But actually what we find out is that a lot of the digital transformation, people don't know what they're talking about. Like they don't even know themselves. Like if you ask them individually, could you three people who are in this room define what digital transformation is? The answer will usually be like, something like that, right? So we go to something deeper to say, there's a model of organization which is becoming more relevant again because the world is becoming a network, because information is being shared more transparently. But this model of work isn't new. There's actually companies that have done this for a long time. So we go back to the original startup garage in Silicon Valley, which I have a special connection to. That was Hewlett-Packard. My dad worked there for like 358 years, it feels. And it was funny, when the speaker before me said, my current employer. I never had that concept. You know, for me, the company that my dad worked at, that was like an extended family. It was the same people that we barbecued with, that we played soccer with. It wasn't like this was a place where my dad got money. He also got money for it. But it was more a social circle, like a professional family, right? So I never got this concept of work being something where you go and then you come back and you're miserable, but something that actually gives you energy. And for me, this is a lot of the symbolism of everything that was right in the beginning about Silicon Valley. And I want to show you this little video to highlight that.
There's this wonderful moment in the company's history. I think it was 1948. And he was at a meeting of business leaders.
There were a whole bunch of CEOs from companies there. And the question that was raised, who is the company responsible to?
And they're all talking about the most important thing is you have to actually focus on returning dollars to your shareholder and maximizing profits.
That's a business model in which the human being is a replaceable part in the manufacturing assembly process.
David Packard stands up and says, actually, I respectfully disagree with all of my elders.
You also have an obligation to your customers and to your employees and to a community in which you operate.
A purpose of a company is not to make money. It makes money in order to be able to do what it's really all about. And in our case, that's to make a contribution.
They laughed at him.
We're here to create things that if we didn't create them, the world would be worse off. And if you don't understand that, you don't understand the HP way.
Right, so 1948, and this was old white people saying that, right? I mean, we all know that HP is not what it used to be, but it started off like that. There was a very clear idea of how this business was run. It was run more on the relationships and not on the process side. It was mentioned before as well. HP had this inner ability to reinvent itself every 10 years. Measurement devices, medical analytics, calculators, printers, PCs. They even made the first smartwatch. But they constantly managed to reinvent themselves ahead of the time because that was at the core of their purpose, to make a contribution to the world of engineering. Right? They had a very clear driver. You can't have a network organization without having this. Now, that's why we put a DeLorean in our office to... what you see here is our research and development team that came to us 2 weeks ago. And when people come to our office, they should see that what we do is actually about going back to the core of what great management is, what we call the network organization. Right? So take a look at this. It's quite an adventure. It was awesome. If it starts. It was funny because I had to be in the car to drive it off, and I called my wife when I was inside of it, and I said, hey, they totally forgot somebody had to be inside of the car and drive it off, and she's like, you're not insured, bye. So this is what we're going to talk about, a technology that we've created which has a very different approach to technology. Right now technology is there and you're being sold technology to say, I got a tool for you and it's going to make your life easier. The moment you buy it, it's going to solve this problem and that problem. What we want is a technology that's almost invisible to you. At best, you don't feel it at all. It wraps around you like an atmosphere, but it should be a workout. It should change behavior. And in the beginning, it's going to be a real pain in the ass. Like, imagine what kind of sales meetings we have, right? We want to sell you a technology that's going to make your life really hard because it's going to expose all the weaknesses that you have. If you really want to work in this digital network kind of way, then we can do that, but you're going to bleed for it. And by the time you succeed, you don't actually need it. It's kind of a different pitch meeting. But this is what's going to come out, right? A company that is very much built around entrepreneurship with minimal bureaucracy. This is the definition. And again, these are not companies that are hip and modern. I mean, look, again, you know, at least I found one woman in there, but these are old white dudes, right? This is, on the left, you have Dave Packard. This is Jan Wallander of the Swedish Handelsbanken, Bill Hewlett, Viv Gore and Bill Gore from Gore-Tex, Chris Rufer from Morningstar, and Ricardo Semler from Semco. And they had this definition, right, to say we want organizations to be forces for good. I mean, the driver, for example, for Bill Hewlett and Dave Packard was, they came from the Second World War, and they said, we just survived the fucking war. We're not going to create a company just to make money. It should do something so that people have a legacy to look back on and say, what we did at work was awesome. What's the best thing that we can give to people? Well, we can let them work like adults. Right now, when people come to work, more or less, they're being handled like children. We tell you when you can go home. We tell you what your objectives are. What we don't do is to say, this is the purpose of the organization. What would you do to get there? We don't treat them like adults in so many ways, but then we have innovation tournaments and all of that to try and see, well, why don't they have ideas like adults if we don't treat them like adults? Remember, we were in the video games industry, so we had to have very simple pictures. The attention span of your average programmer is 2.5 seconds when he talks to an HR person, and that's a good attention span. So you have to get food, right? Food is always helpful to get a programmer's attention. So what we said is, what we don't want is a hamburger organization. A lot of bun, very little meat. What we want is a burrito organization, very little wrap, a lot of meat. And they go, oh yeah. So actually this became the metaphor in the organization. We didn't talk about the network organization or agile or anything. They said, yeah, so that's not burrito-like because basically you're adding a lot of bun, and nobody ever bought a hamburger for a good bun, right? So these are the kind of simple messages that we worked with. I mentioned digital workout. Who knows this dude? Chris Pratt, Guardian of the Galaxy, right? This is what he looked like when he was in Parks and Recreation. And then somebody from Marvel called him and said, dude, you can be a superhero. You got 6 months to look like all the other Avengers, minus Robert Downey Jr. And he's like, 6 months? No problem. Look at me now. I never show this when my wife is in the audience. It's not ending well for me. But what people miss is the middle part. Blood, sweat, tears, and a lot of puking. It's the same thing when you transform your organization, right? That's what our tools do. They really make you puke. It's like a digital workout. What we say is that work is a product. You can reinvent your car. Mercedes could stop now and make an electric car. They just choose not to, right? Because they would have to throw all the components away and start from scratch. And they've learned to make V8s and V12s, so they're not just going to copy the shit out of Musk. But you could redefine work like a product. It's just made by humans. You can change the processes that you have. Here's the model to that, right? We say in the past, in the industrial age, there was a very simple model. There was a boss and a worker. One guy went to university. This is awesome. I feel like I'm in the urban jungle. And then there were the minions, and the minions had to be told what to do because only one guy went to university, you remember? And the others were Charlie Chaplin and away. They did their job well, but at 5 o'clock they punched out and they went home. Now we have this new thing. We go up a little bit. We establish more clarity, more purpose. There's a little bit more competency to self-organize, which means that the good boss will ask her team, how would you solve this problem? And the team will respond, say, we would do it this and that and this way. Or which direction do you think we should go? And they will brainstorm or think out of the box or throw the box away or be the box to eliminate the box. Still chewing on that one. That was great. So that's what in Germany right now you call working on eye level, right? But it's still the same paradigm, all the responsibilities with the boss. It's still an approval culture. If the right guy wants to do something, he has to get approval from the left girl. But then when we go to the top, and that's where we have a very different logic in these companies that I showed you for decades now, where they said, we've given you an enormous amount of clarity about the purpose of the organization. You have a high degree of clarity of our priorities. I expect everybody here to work like a leader. Leadership is not a position, it's not a hierarchy. It doesn't matter if you're white or old or whatever. We want people to work in the interest of the customer to make a contribution. And everybody has to make transparent, hashtag working out loud, what they're doing so that everybody else can veto it and say, hey, I heard what you want to do, I think it's a shitty idea. Or I heard what you want to do and I want to be part of it. Or I heard what you want to do and I really couldn't care less. Yeah? But it turns the logic around from approval to veto. That's the prerequisite, right? Let's go back to that. It says the organization that's connecting all the individuals without a hierarchy, without barriers, needs this clarity of purpose and priorities. Then you can get rid of the artificial hierarchy. You need to let the information flow freely. Think about how much money SAP makes right now with different access level to information. It's crazy. But if you have different access level to information, you make different quality decisions. That's not an entrepreneurial mindset. And then in the end, everybody is arguing about the customer benefit, not about their ego. But you need this clarity for it. And this is hard. This is a hard burden on leadership to create this level of clarity. Case in point, Jan Wallander, right? The old dude from Swedish Handelsbank. If you go to Deutsche Bank, for example, and you want a credit, and you fail a payment on something, then the Deutsche Banker has no fucking responsibility, no mandate to cut you slack. Even if he knows you and he knows that you've only missed this payment because you overslept, but you got a million in the bank, there's an algorithm in London that says you're a risk, you're not getting that mortgage. At Handelsbanken, it's different. Every client, up to the highest private client, has to deal with the representative in the branch. The branch representative is king. He makes the decisions, she makes the decisions, but she also has her feet in the fire if she makes the wrong call. There's no algorithm in London saving her ass. So the downfall, what is the Deutsche Bank guy doesn't give a crap about their customer. They don't have to. They don't have to learn anything about them because they can't make a decision. The pressure on this person is much higher in Handelsbanken, but also the responsibility and the meaning of their job because they suddenly invested in getting to know their clients and making the right decisions. So this is where this comes in. I'll show you the technology. How do we get into the hearts and minds of the leaders? Because in all the transformations we've seen, the employees, you get them pretty quickly. In the beginning, also the executives, because they say, oh yeah, fine, go ahead and do that agile thing, right? And then you say, well, you actually need to change too. Hold on, us, change, are you crazy? We're on top of the ivory tower. Do you know how long it took to get here? That's what the dive does. The network is the performance management system. How do we organize work in the future differently? And then as an example, how do you get over that, I think what Arne called it, the hump of cynicism. How do you break through that built up stagnation of, ugh, not another change program, please. Let's take a look. When I was the head of HR at Crytek, there was like 5 people worldwide who were doing what we were doing, transforming companies. That was before Zappos and all of these guys. So I was trying to reach out to people who were doing this just to get an idea of where could we avoid at least one of the mistakes that we made along the way. And I got a call, and I was actually not a call, it was a message on Skype, and a guy called me and said, hey, we're doing the same thing that you're doing. Maybe we can talk. And I'm like, awesome. His name was David. Let's talk. Can you do Sunday, 2 a.m. in the morning? I'm like, what's 2 a.m.? What can you? I mean, back then I only had one child, but still it was a shitty time. I was like, well, there's only so many people I can talk to about this. Let's do it. Sunday, 2 a.m., I get on Skype, and all I hear is... I'm like, that's not starting well. I'm like, David, I got up for you, a godforsaken hour. Can you go somewhere where I can actually hear you? This sucks, right? You're clonk, clonk, clonk. And then we talk. And we talk for maybe 15 minutes, and I'm ready to have this guy's baby. This man love. So at the end, at the end of those 15 minutes, I finally ask him, I'm like, David, what company do you work for, man? And he's like, company? I don't work for a company. I'm a captain of a U.S. Navy submarine. the USS Santa Fe, Los Angeles class, fast attack submarine. I'm like, yeah, whatever. Where are the cameras? But it was true. David was a nuclear submarine commander. Here's what happened to him. I don't know if any of you know the story. He wrote a great book. If you want to read a great management book for this Christmas, it's called Turn the Ship Around. David was assigned to the USS Olympia, which was an older kind submarine, which he can dent because it was the first time he became a captain. He had to study for a year because in the Navy, the best engineer becomes the captain. You know the boat inside out. If this light switch flickers, it's because of that wiring over there. He knew everything better than anybody on board. He was the head honcho. 1 week before he was meant to leave with the Olympia, he gets a call from the fleet headquarters and they say, David, we got news for you. Our most modern nuclear submarine, the USS Santa Fe, the captain just called and he said, either he's gonna sink the fucking ship or he's gonna kill everybody on board because it's the worst crew ever, or we send him into early retirement. We can't afford a mass killing on a submarine. You're the turnaround guy. Go. So he had 1 week to prepare for the most modern submarine in the fleet. And he said, well, the least I could do was watch Hunt for Red October and pretend I'm Sean Connery. So I walk on the bridge and pretend it's like that long. Go. All right. First officer. This is in the harbor of Honolulu, mind you. Put in the second gear. Take us out of the harbor. 50 knots straight ahead. First officer stands here. Clicks his heels, goes, yes, aye, Captain, helmsman, 50 knots, second gear, go ahead. Helmsman sits here. Nothing. David goes, shit, that's not how this was supposed to go. Helmsman, are you okay? The ship is not moving. Helmsman goes, white as chalk. Captain, this ship doesn't have a second gear, sir. David goes, uh-oh. Hey, first officer, did you know that the Santa Fe didn't have a second gear? Yes, Captain, I knew that, sir! Can you tell me why you told him to put the second gear in if you knew that it didn't have one? I did not, sir, you did. I just passed it on, sir. Okay. Internal monologue. I am the biggest risk to world peace. I'm sitting on a nuclear reactor and 16 missiles that have nuclear tips. Mind you, that was under Obama. Today, he'd be the second biggest risk to world peace. What do? I have to change something. Okay, he's like, middle management, you have shown you have no value add. Step aside. Helmsman, your representative in touch with the customer. Would you agree with me, the purpose of the Santa Fe is to safeguard the free world? Aye, Captain, that's why I signed up to the Navy. Would you agree with me that if we go kaboom in a nuclear mushroom in the harbor of Honolulu, we can't possibly safeguard the free world? He said, yes, Captain, I agree. And a personal note, sir, I would not like to be disintegrated. Good. Would you agree with me that first priority would be to get this ship out of the harbor without hitting anything or anyone? Yes, Captain. Make it so. And please talk to everybody on the bridge to make sure that everything we need to do to get out of this harbor has been done. He's like, but Captain, you have to order that. He's like, you have just seen that I have no clue about this submarine. What would you do? Like, close the hatches, take the ropes, you know? He's like, all right. Hey, Henry, have you taken all the ropes? Yeah. Have you closed the hatches, Mike? Yeah. Okay. Any problems? No, let's go. I'm glad that I found this out much later because these are nuclear missiles, right? And anyways, so here's something funny that happened. A year later, Santa Fe was tested, you know, because they always have these dick measuring contests where they fight against other navies. And Santa Fe became the best ship tested. Not that year, not in the Pacific, ever tested. Why? Because that system had taken hold, this veto system instead of the approval system. So even the fastest acting hierarchy ship, where the captain would give the best orders, and David would be the first to admit to say, there are captains out there who can get the shit out of me. They know a lot more about their submarine. But I have 150 thinking proactive guys in my boat who think with me. So if I have to say, Captain, we've spotted an enemy. May I go active on sonar? Approved, you may go active on sonar. May I launch a missile. You may launch a missile. Okay, may I detonate the missile? You may detonate the missile. That's what, 6 seconds. On a Santa Fe, Captain, based on mission parameters, I have locked on target and shot an enemy is kapitch. 3 seconds. That's why they were better. And David could have said stop, because he heard what was going on, right? So what we did was we took the Voyage of David on Santa Fe and we recreated it in VR. It's called The Dive.
Absolutely astonishing.
That's Santa Fe.
When I walked in, I really wasn't sure what I was actually walking into.
That's what that looks like. They're sitting there like this. And this is actually a very special setup right now, but you would have helm, engineering, weapons, and the captain. And they're sharing the bridge. And in this case, what we've done is we've installed a dummy captain. So you see here, the actual CEO, so we will actually man the stations like this. Engineering with all the energy will be the CFO because he's giving all the energy to the organization. Weapons will usually be the chief strategy officer. Helm will be HR, head of HR, and then captain will be CEO. And you will not believe the kind of conversations you have up there. Like literally, the mission we've created is that you have to cross into North Korean waters to save a ship that's being sunk. So they have to make a decision if they cross into North Korean waters. Most of them just plow right in. And at some point, they have like six destroyers around them. Like, hey, why is somebody attacking us? Do you see that big red line? That's the North Korean line. And you just went over it. It's like, hey, yeah, it's just like how we do it in business. We always think about it after what we've done wrong. Okay, let's do a little transfer learning here, right? So this is an extremely powerful method to immerse the leaders in a different kind of leadership format and to show them, here's how you need to change in your role. So as an architect of the organization, you can enable the rest of your staff to work like this because it will always fail with you or succeed. We're saying these are three dimensions, right? Do you want to become a network organization? Do you have the purpose and the clarity? Do you have the skills to self-organize? And does the organizational architecture, the processes, actually enable it? Right now, most of organizations do a great job despite the organization, not because of it. So when we whittle this down, we say this is actually what it comes down to. Most of it is fear on part of the leadership. What am I doing here? Can I do this responsibly? Are we going to lose money if I do this? Habit and mental models. This is not how I was taught. That's not how submarine captains act. I was supposed to do something different as the head of HR. We have central processes like the Deutsche Bank with an algorithm in London, and the tech doesn't really help, right? It's just there like an SAP that portrays what you do, but it doesn't help you to change. So we're saying this is the biggest risk. Like that's how CEOs feel who come to work with us. I don't know if you've seen this, but this is their fear when you say, do you want to change? And they go, well, this could happen to me.
And close your eyes and just fall down, okay? Don't worry.
Okay, then Lauren's going to catch you.
Close your eyes,
you.
Close your eyes. Okay.
Okay, it's called the trust fall. Okay, trust fall. Ready, set, go.
Right? Most CEOs have a fear that if they start self-organizing, their team's going to let them down and go the other way. But actually, it's a lack of clarity on their part to say, fall backwards and I'll catch you, right? There's a level of clarity involved to make it right. And well, that was a painful lesson, but remember, I grew up everywhere, but my co-founder, she's German, and she said, if you want to have any rate of success in Germany, we have to have a four-grid model, yes? The Germans respond well to the four grids. So we made a four-grid model, right? We say, look, it's like, there's like four archetypes of organizations, right? And one is the mind and the skill set that people go in with, and the other one is the organizational architecture. So on top, you have your typical Berlin startup. It runs on Red Bull. But there's no method at all. It's just try to make the next rent and pivot and pivot and pivot. Anything goes. It's the Wild West. Pioneers. The bottom left is the exact polar opposite. It's like your central organization where five white dudes have a spreadsheet with 500,000 people that they do with their, as they like. So people feel just like resources. And it's highly centralized. And then VW goes, we don't know who was responsible for the cheating scandal. The bottom right is where it gets interesting, right? Those are the small to medium-sized businesses. Because there you have a tug of war happening. You got this thing where, what my speaker before me said, with the different sized tribes, if I still know what your name is, and I really care about the outcome, and I know that you can help me get that outcome done, and help me with this customer, all I have to do is bring you a latte macchiato. Then you'll get this done for me in 2 hours tops. If I go through the SLA-approved Sarbanes-Oxley process, compliant, blah, 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 and queue the ticket, then it's first in, first out, and I know that you're going to see this ticket maybe on Thursday next week. So if I really care, what do? Ticket or latte macchiato? Latte macchiato. The guys in the back are like, I'm so glad I didn't go up front. So what happens then is that these companies up there, they did something completely different. They said the latte macchiato will become our operating model. Remember, I'm back to food, programmers, or drink, falls under nutrition. But how do you do that? How do you get an organization to go from the bottom right to the top right? Because that doesn't happen by accident. That needs to be designed. To go from organization as an inhibitor to actually a customer-centric model. Here's what it looks like. When you do it with our technology, you would come out with something like this. This is T-Mobile as a network, where we started our first big project. Now, every dot on that map is a person, and every connection is a working connection between them. So what you see here is clusters of work relationships. How would you say HR feels about its connection to the rest of the organization? Not so great, right? But it's okay because the shared services in general are doing shit, so finance and legal are in the same boat. They're like the appendices of the organization, right? But that's not mission critical. What's more critical to the organization, something like T-Mobile, is outsourced customer service and in-house customer service are disconnected. So if you want to serve the customer as a network and you have two parts of the organization facing the customer that are doing things that are not aligned, that's a risk. Sales and marketing, not very well integrated, that's a risk. Very different way of looking at the organization. And this is real time. This updates constantly. I'll show you how. We show this to CEOs and we said, would you be more comfortable to start the transformation if you could actually visualize it in real time? If we could show you in real time where the priorities of these organizations lie, gold, silver, and bronze, you can see where your people spend the most time and with which customer. Very easily accessible. You can see if it's healthy or not healthy. You can just toggle the view and say, oh, gold priority, that's our most important. Is that green or is it red? Well, let's toggle the view. And then we can take a look at it. Looks good. Only the silvers are red. Well, they're not mission critical, right? So they get a different view of the organization, and suddenly they don't have a feeling that they're falling forward and they're not being caught because the organization is feeding them data in real time about how the organization is working. Are we providing value for the customer? You can scale this, right? It's just a different zoom level. It's just a different way of looking at your organization, but it's real time because it updates as the people update their work relationships. You can even update and see in real time how the money flows through the organization. So everything becomes much more like an internal startup ecosystem. That means everybody who does anything that requires money has to log it into the system, and then you can see how the money or the budgets flow through the system in a dynamic way. So you can say, if this is our biggest source of revenue and the money flows from the A into our organization on the top right, does that make money? Looking at a shared picture and we're trying to make sense of it, right? So the executives get confidence that the transformation might actually work because they get a feeling, and they can even go down to a team level, how the team manages itself and says, well, is it working well or not? These are the people and the contributions that they're working on a micro level, on a squad level, an autonomous team that is just mapping, what are we working on? Here's how you start. Everybody who wants to start anything in this organization has to map it. So if you came into a Resourceful Humans Network organization, you would be presented with a blank canvas and people would say, with your talent and your energy, how would you contribute? You've seen what we do, who would you work with? Do we work with him, with her? What would you do? And then you have to fill out a couple of things, like what title would you give this? Like a Kickstarter. What organizational priority does this attach to, gold, silver, or bronze? Definition of done. How does the customer experience that what you have done has created value? Collaborators, who do you want to work with? Who do you need to get this done? When will it be done? And how much money do you need for it? And how much money do you think it'll be make? And then you hit contribute, and then the other person would get the invite and say, do you want to work with that person on that? And if they don't, no connection. Then you can't start it. You need to actually convince people to work with you, or you need to convince people that you can contribute to their contribution. That requires that everybody in the organization can also make a case for what they're doing. So when we work with organizations, we say, hey, okay, guys, you have to be able to make a case. Even if you're in HR, you have to be able to put this into money. And this might be opportunity cost. So it's not directly correlated, but it's causal, but it's correlated. So you could say, oh, how many people am I losing per year that I don't want to lose? You put in some parameters and you can say it costs us 41 million euros a year. Well, there you got your benefit. If you get that down 20%, you've saved money. But you have to be able to do that. Otherwise, you can't get an entrepreneurial ecosystem going. And this is hard for people. Remember the Chris Pratt picture? This is hard. So this is what it looks like. If I invite somebody and the other person gets the choice, do I want to work with that person or not? And if they do, then you can actually visualize it and say, Heiko's working with Pepper on something. It's very simple, but try to make the mental math if you switched this on in your organization, what would happen? Mark Klein switched this on at T-Mobile with the Workers' Council head, with Emma Chapman. And this is what it looks like when they switch it on a little bit for the rest of T-Mobile. Because it's so nice. Take a look at it again. This is from the perspective of the group CEO. The T-Mobile CEO, Mark Klein, asked, hey, Tim Höttges, can I do this? And he said, let's pretend you didn't ask me. Just start walking with the ball. And then run like that. And the numbers prove him right. So here's the interesting bit. This is the board of T-Mobile. They started by creating a business canvas for the purpose. We asked them to do this in 2 months. It took us 8. Why? It's fucking hard to create that clarity. They had different kind of ideas where this organization should go. It took forever to get them going. We did this in theory with them. We said, just position yourself in a room. Forget the tool. Remember, the tool is just a digital representation of what you're doing. Position yourself in the room the way you're working together. Super close if you're working with each other really tightly, a little bit further away if you're not working with each other so tightly. And then you see the big blob there in the middle? Those are the middle managers. And they were like, we don't need you, we're a network already, everything's cool, yay. We're like, okay, could we just check the two ladies that you're looking at with your ass? Who are they? Oh, retail and customer service. You don't say. The two people in touch with the customer. Shouldn't they be at the center of this? It's just whatever. Yeah. So what we said is, we went to the customer service people. We said, let's engage in a little bit of cultural hacking. What would you need in the organization to feel that you're at the center and that you can make a difference with the customer, that you can really contribute? And let's put this in the context of a shit list, things we just need to stop doing, and a wish list, things we should do on top so we could do better or differently. What do you think? What's the usual distribution? Okay, it's 6 o'clock, you're not gonna answer anyway. So the usual distribution is 80% of the stuff that you do in the organization is just to stop it. First and foremost, performance management. They're just like, it has never helped anybody to perform better. It just takes time away, okay? And it's just for the 2% that we need to fire that we have a reason legally. Just give them a severance, right? And save us the time. So actually, there's a lot of things that you just need to stop doing and it'll be better. This was the biggest hack that they came up with. They called it the 5-minute hack. And this was documented in a network system. The customer representative said, if we could actually answer the customer, be it in web support or in the retail store, or wherever, in 5 minutes tops to the satisfaction of the customer, that would be different. That would be a real differentiator. Because I don't know how your telecom is here in Hungary, but in Germany, you don't count in minutes, you count in weeks. Yeah, so that was a real game changer. Because they said, what do we need now? From IT, for example, they said, well, right now I have 10 different IT systems. If a customer approaches me, I have to log into 10 different systems. Two I don't have approval for. Three give me different information. The other ones take 10 minutes to load. I have no idea. Yeah, so the backlog for IT was 2 minutes loading time, one screen, so that they have 3 minutes to talk to the customer. Okay, go. If you can't contribute to that, what are you here for? This was the leadership hack. They said, okay, every leader in the organization has to put this warning sign in their office, which means every employee can hold every leader accountable to it. No pressure. But being corporate, they obviously put a competency model behind it. What does it take to be an asshole in an organization? I think that's awesome. All right, we had this idea before where somebody said, Alf was talking about this CEO, the big blustering CEO, and it was really smart, right? How he primed us against the CEO, and then the guy just said all the right things. But this is crucial, to set this environment, be it us at Resource for Humans, David on his submarine, or back in the day at 1950 at HP, where a guy basically had an idea for a product, built a prototype, the CEO did management by walking around, came to this guy's desk, and said, what are you doing there, Chuck? And Chuck said, oh, I'm building this awesome new screen. He's like, that has no market. I don't want to see that in the lab again next time I'm here. So Chuck thought, I really believe in this product, and he just said it shouldn't be in the lab. If it's in production, it's not technically in the lab. So he put it into production, and lo and behold, that thing actually sold really well. So what did the CEO do? Was he undermined because he gave an order and the order wasn't followed? No. In the town hall meeting with everybody in Palo Alto, he handed them a Medal of Defiance. And he said, this is great, this is great engineering. When your boss says shit, ignore him. Right? Sometimes I say nonsense, and you've proven, because you've sold nearly 18,000 of those, that you were right. And even if you weren't, sometimes you just have to be a maverick. But the CEO, the board has to set that tone that it's safe to try shit, because then that'll start, right? And then people also start to think responsibly. Now, this is where the AI comes in, and this is what I'll end on with for you. Because now we have to maintain it, right? So if we have the network organization, how do we maintain these relationships? So what we've said is that everybody needs to set the status of each contribution. Let's say that we're working on business development, and it's two of us, Kevin and me, we're working on business development down there on the right, and we're green right now. Now, if Kevin set it to red in his activity view and you say, you know what, I think business development's not going so well. I just talked to a customer and he said, you didn't call him back as you promised. I'm setting this to red. Then we're applying the law of good marriage, which means the sex only needs to be bad for one person for it to suck for both, that everybody goes red. Right? So the idea is that you think as a team. Even if there's 16 people in a contribution and just one person sets it on red, everybody goes red. Everybody should suddenly think, why you put that on red? How do you get back to green? But when we did this in a large corporate, what happened was that everybody just set it on green and said, I'm not going to set my boss's contribution on red. Are you fucking crazy? It's career suicide. And we're like, but that's in the interest of the customer. They were like, interest, schminterest. Career suicide, dude. We're like, okay, well, we're building a feature that every 7 days, this thing's going to go to red until you go in and actually proactively put it to green. They're like, what? That's unfair. We're like, no, that's exactly what you want. But it's not pleasant, right? People hate this tool. But it gets them to where they want to be. They actually have to exchange on what they want to do. Since I've been getting all these warning messages, I'll end you with this. On a high, so we can all go out. Can we? No? Come on. What am I doing wrong? There you go.
Everything you people have told me, I didn't have the technology, I didn't have the right contacts, I didn't have the time, I didn't have money. Everything you've told me, I didn't have enough Supreme Court justices, those are resources. And so you're telling me I failed because I didn't have the resources. And I'm here to tell you what you already know. Resources are never the problem. It's a lack of resourcefulness is why you failed. Because the ultimate resources are emotional states. Creativity, decisiveness, passion, honesty, sincerity, love. These are the ultimate human resources. And when you engage these resources, you can get any other resource on earth. Resourcefulness is the ultimate resource. And if you don't have what you want, stop telling yourself the story because you don't have the money, you don't have the time. That's bullshit. It's because you haven't committed yourself where you would burn your boats. If you want to take the fucking island, burn your fucking boats. And you will take the island because people, when they're going to either die or succeed, tend to succeed.
And on that cheery note, we end. Thank you.
Thank you very much. By the way, David 2 years ago was one of our speakers.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I think I connected him even.
Okay, so let's turn to questions. First one. But can it run crisis?
Fuck yeah. I don't know if you know this joke, but crisis used to be like a processor melting game. So you would test your PC against crisis on the highest settings. And NVIDIA actually tested their graphics cards with it. So they took pride in the fact that graphics cards melted at the highest setting of this computer games setting. So, yeah, but, you know, the VR PCs these days is like easy peasy.
Yeah, speaking of a video game, so which game development company worked with, mentioned earlier?
Talk about the guy who asked about Crysis, he knows.
Yeah, but the rest of the people?
Yeah, yeah, Crytek.
Okay.
They have an office here in Hungary. They had an office here in Hungary.
Cool. How are the visualization in your presentations made, underlying logic used and tools, please?
Yeah, let's make a date. That's a bit longer.
What's the tool you used?
That's our proprietary technology, network. Yeah.
Okay.
That's the tool that we sell. If that didn't come across, I failed in the last 40 minutes to tell you that. Thank you for that question.
Perhaps,
I'm leaving now.
Perhaps.
Bye.
Perhaps it came at the very beginning, right?
Yeah, at the very beginning, yes.
So how do you get the buy-in from management for these big organizational transformations?
Honestly, we just put them in touch with other CEOs that have worked with us. There's no way to sell this. So what you say is, I can connect you to three other people who have done this, ask them if it was worth it, and then you can come to us and we can tell you how we would do it. But there's no sales pitch to it.
So it's like a word of mouth thing?
Yes. We really suck with business development. Like, one of the CEOs told us, making business with resourceful humans is like going uphill in a snowstorm at night in a blizzard, coming to a hut that is locked. You have to break in through the window where a guy is asleep at the desk, and you have to wake him up, which he won't, but you have to put his hand on a piece of paper to sign it so you can have a contract and make business. There you go.
Got it. Okay, and does your company actually own a real DeLorean?
What did it come across? Like, you think they would loan me one to put into the building? Yeah, we own a real DeLorean. And it's really cool because when you come in, it's the first thing you see. And, you know, we really believe in the same thing that Steve Jobs believed, that you first and foremost build brands. Like, the technology will change, right? But we will always come up with something that will help organizations work as a network. And the DeLorean hits it home that when you open the door into the biggest meeting room and you go in, and there's a DeLorean, and you go, yeah, these guys are fucking nuts. I want to do business with them.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Take your cup, please.
Take my cup.
And please give a big round of applause.
Thank you.